So welcome everyone to the Designing Cinder session. So we're going to go on through some introductions and then the agenda, and then we'll walk through the session itself. So Jim, do you want to start?
Sure. Hi, everyone. I'm Jim Ruddy. I'm from EMC. I work in the office of the CTO in something called the Open Innovation Labs.
And my name is John Griffith. I work at SolidFire. I'm the PTO for Cinder. I'm a software engineer at SolidFire, and OpenStack is what I do.
My name is Kenneth Hoy. I am a technology evangelist of Rackspace, and Rackspace is partners with both EMC and SolidFire, so my job is to keep them from fighting.
Good luck.
So quick agenda is, we're going to, let me ask, how many of you are familiar with Cinder, or currently using it? And some, okay, great.
Nice.
Perfect. Cool. Let me ask another question. How many of you are using Cinder with commodity storage? How many are using it with some kind of enterprise storage solution? Okay, that doesn't equal the number of people who said they use Cinder.
Something didn't add up here.
It's ephemeral Cinder. Okay, so what we're going to do is we'll walk through a little bit what Cinder is, but the assumption here is that you guys know, have the basics down. The meat of this presentation really is going to be looking at real life examples of how to actually deploy Cinder in production environment with commodity storage and with also enterprise arrays. And then hopefully at the end of the session, depending on how much time we have left, we'll take some questions and then we may be able to do some kind of a demo. But our main focus is going to be talking about actual use cases and lessons learned from deploying Cinder in an OpenStack production environment. So with that, I'm going to let John kind of do the introduction on Cinder.
Okay. So for those of you that are already familiar with this, you'll have to excuse me, but I'll try and make this brief. One of the first questions I get asked a lot, I talk about Cinder a lot, and one of the first questions I get asked is always, what's the difference between Cinder and Swift? So on the Cinder side, we have block storage. On the Swift side, it's object storage. That's kind of that's the big thing, right? So significantly different use cases, significantly different models, how it's consumed, everything about it. So they are not the same thing. They definitely have their own unique use cases. If there's any questions or anything like that, I'm happy to answer them real quick. Nope, okay, good. So we can just blow by this.
By the way, if you have questions, there is a mic in the middle.
Yeah.
So it'll probably be easier if you try to come up to the mic.
So the whole point of Cinder is to give you your traditional block storage. And when I say traditional block storage, we're talking about things like disk drives. The way people like to think of it, and an example that Ken uses a lot that I really like, is the idea is you're taking a very specialized USB thumb drive and plugging it into your OpenStack instance, right? So that's kind of the idea. It's your persistent block level storage that can be used by Nova either as a secondary attached disk or even as the boot disk for the root disk inside of Nova. Cinder itself will manage all the provisioning, creation, attach, detach, everything else that you need to do with volumes, with block storage volumes. And the whole idea is, as an end user, you don't have to worry about things like what is the back end, what's the interface look like, how do I use that API, et cetera, et cetera. So, the base features in the Cinder API, it's really actually kind of simple. Of course, you have create and delete. We have a thing called volume types inside of Cinder, and the whole idea of volume types is to give you the ability to expose custom functionality without breaking the API. You have the ability to do clones. Some back-end devices allow you to do highly efficient, you know, fast cloning and things like that. You have the ability to put an image on a volume so that you can boot off of it. Snapshots, which are just point-in-time copies. Creating a volume from those snapshots is another thing you can do. One of the complaints people have is, I have this snapshot, I can't do anything with it. Well, sure you can, create a volume from it. We give you the ability to backup Cinder volumes right now. So you can backup a Cinder volume to an object store, any S3 compatible object store. There's even a tape driver right now for TSM. You can transfer the ownership of a volume. So one tenant can create a volume and use it, and then decide to give it to another tenant. You can set that up inside of Cinder right now. And then, of course, we have the scheduling filters and things like that that kind of dig into the guts a little bit more. But.
Hey, John, before you go on, do you want to talk a little bit about what's the use cases that you that the Cinder team envisioned when they were creating Cinder values?
Yeah, so in terms of the use cases, the things that we look at is, you know, initially you had, of course, you know, object store, which is great for doing things like dumping media files or photos and things like that. But the reality is, you know, as the cloud evolves and things mature, you actually want to run real workloads in your cloud deployments. I mean, that's the whole point, is to change your IT department, right, and use the cloud. The problem is you need persistent storage to do that. You need performant persistent storage to do things like run a MySQL database or an Oracle database or whatever it might be. So that's the idea. The idea is to satisfy the need for persistent, high rate of access block storage. You know, whether that be as a secondary attached model or as the root drive or whatever the case might be. So.
Stay on that.
So, okay.
That's you.
Yep, we're good.
Yeah, so at Rackspace, the other primary use case for using Cinder actually is the ability to do rapid recovery. So one of the things you may know if you're using OpenStack is prior to Cinder volumes, there was really just the concept of ephemeral storage for SCSI access. But the problem with ephemeral was if the node went down, well, first of all, if you terminate the instance, all the data gets purged. But also, if the compute node went down, you lost access because typically that was direct attached storage. So one of the things that Cinder can do is, since it is a storage that can be attached and then detached, and then reattached to another node instance, if your compute node failed, the idea is you could bring up an instance on a separate compute node and then just basically reattach that volume to a new instance, and you would retain all the data, let's say that's running on a MySQL database. But anyway, so let me talk a bit about the commodity storage use case, because in Rackspace in particular, we find that is probably 70% of the use case, especially in greenfield type of deployments where there's no existing enterprise storage solution in place for an OpenStack deployment. And from a hardware standpoint, I'll have a picture later to kind of walk through this, but from a hardware standpoint, there's really, the components are really around a control node. So in OpenStack world, all the controlling services typically reside on two or more nodes that you've created, and that's where you put your metadata database and your, say, your API endpoints. And then there's also storage networking, which we'll talk a bit about later, and then the storage itself. And then on those nodes, you're going to basically spread out your software components of OpenStack Cinder. So on the controller nodes, typically, it's where you put your Cinder APIs, endpoints, and then your Cinder scheduler. So the API endpoints are basically how you interact with OpenStack to say, hey, I want a volume created, and I want that volume to be attached to an instance. And then on the scheduler, basically, is a process that runs. It's a process that runs on the control node that basically, when you are provisioning a new volume, it looks at all your storage backends and basically tries to load balance them across all your storage backends. So that sits on the controller node itself. And then because typically Cinder is running on iSCSI protocol attachment, you want a iSCSI network. So again, in Rackspace, we do not recommend trying to run your normal Ethernet control traffic on the same network as your storage traffic. So typically, you want a dedicated 10 gig iSCSI network, right? That goes from your backend array or commodity server to your compute nodes, which would basically then pull a virtual volume that's served out by your storage, and then the instances would basically plug into those volumes. Next one. And then there's another software component. It's called a Cinder volume. And that is the piece within Cinder that basically takes a volume and exports it out to an instance to be attached to. So in a commodity storage type environment, and the way to think about a commodity storage type of deployment within OpenStack for Cinder, think of that it's typically a server that has some internal storage that essentially functions as a virtual storage array. This is our recommended configuration, right, for how much memory and how much CPU power you need to run that virtual storage array. So this is a high-level diagram of a typical OpenStack deployment using Rackspace private cloud. So you see here on those, we have two controller nodes, right, for redundancy, and you see that's where we have the API service and the schedule service across both controller nodes for failover purposes. And then the compute nodes themselves really talk to the Cinder node volume using the iSCSI network on the bottom. Now, obviously, we want redundant network switches if at all possible. And then the Cinder node itself, again, in this in a typical Rackspace deployment, is basically a Dell server that has anywhere from 6 to 8 drives in it. And those drives can be SSDs, they can be nearline SAS, they can be 15 or 10K SAS, depending on customer requirements. So what are the advantages? Why look at commodity storage, right? So obviously the initial cost is fairly low, right? Especially if you have if you only need, say, like 2 terabytes, right? Rather than buying a big storage array to start, you can just buy a Dell server or an HP server, whatever, or even a white box server, put Cinder volume service on it, and now you have a storage array, quote unquote, to use. Obviously, if the server team that's typically running the OpenStack deployment, they don't have to go to the storage team to procure the resource. They just have to procure a server with some amount of storage behind it. And again, the reference implementation for Cinder and commodity is using LVM. So if you have a Linux admin who's typically the one running OpenStack, they can set up a Cinder volume fairly easily. Some of the limitations. So, and I'm gonna kind of draw this out a little bit more in some of the next slides. But one issue is there is no redundancy. The Cinder volume is essentially a single point of failure. Also, a storage. I mentioned using a Dell server with eight drives. That's your capacity scaling limit for that one Cinder volume. And obviously, commodity storage doesn't. It only provides services that Cinder itself has as part of OpenStack. There's no other services such as QoS and tiering or replication that you would normally expect from an enterprise storage system. So let me draw out some of the examples on the next slide. So you see here in a typical environment, you can have multiple Cinder volumes servers running in an OpenStack deployment. But note that the two are not in it. They do not. It's a true share nothing architecture. They're not sharing anything at all. So if a Cinder volume fails, you've lost all access to that storage until that volume is until that server is replaced, which obviously creates HA problems if you're running that type of load where you don't have HA replication up at the application level. If you're relying on the infrastructure to provide it, you will not get that commodity storage use case. And I talked about the limits of capacity. So again, you can use different drive types, different drive sizes in a Cinder deployment. We typically use 15K SAS because a lot of times we're running things like Postgres or MySQL, which requires that kind of I/O performance. So if you look at a typical Dell server that we would use for a Cinder volume node, we're talking just over 2 terabytes usable. So as you can see, if I need 8 terabytes, now you're looking at 4 Cinder volumes, none of which share information with each other. So over time, if you start getting into the multi-terabyte type of deployment, now you're looking at an entire farm of additional storage servers that you must procure, power, and manage. So. Before I kind of move on to the enterprise storage piece of the presentation, are there any questions about commodity storage? Do you mind going to the mic if you can, just so people can hear the question?
So in the previous figure, you mentioned about MySQL 8 TB, right? So can you please go to the previous slide?
I'm sorry?
Can you please go to the previous slide?
Yeah.
So here MySQL database with 8 TB requirement. So this is, but the MySQL database will be on the API or the scheduler. Like this is, can you please elaborate on this?
So I think there might be some confusion there. So
this database is basically, so is this some kind of an application you're talking about? Or this space consumed by the volumes that are created on the backend?
I'm giving an example of a application that may have requirements for some amount of storage that's greater than one Cinder volume can hold. Okay. So since the scaling limit of a commodity storage is typically what the server can host, you're forced to break up that application across multiple storage nodes. And my whole point really is, again, if you get into the multi-terabytes, now the cost of ownership becomes very high.
Okay.
The number of servers you have to manage.
Sure, thanks.
Any other questions about commodity storage, Cinder? No? Okay, so John, you want to talk?
Okay, again? So one of the cool things about Cinder is you actually have choices, right? So Ken talked about the commodity storage. I call it the reference architecture or the LVM implementation. So you get that for free, that's built in, but it has the caveats that Ken mentioned, right? But the thing that's cool is what Cinder does is it uses a plug-in model and a plug-in architecture so that what you can do is you can use other storage platforms, and whether it's EMC, SolidFire, NetApp, Ceph, whatever it might be. And you can plug that in and use that just as effectively as you could anything else that's built inside of Cinder right now. So that's the cool thing. The other thing that's really cool about that is you don't have to choose just one. You can mix and match. You can start with one today. You can start with the LVM reference implementation today, buy a SolidFire tomorrow, buy a NetApp, buy whatever, and you keep going. You can just keep adding. So it's true scale out, and it's designed to work in that manner. So it's a huge advantage. So this is kind of another take on Ken's slide. It's the exact same thing, and this is just kind of, I wanted to display the fact that it's truly plug-in, right? So the idea is we took the exact same architecture, the exact same principles and everything else that we use for the LVM driver, and instead now we just popped in a SolidFire array. That's the only difference.
Well, the other thing is you notice on here that whereas in the commodity storage, the Cinder volume service had to run on that storage node.
Yeah.
In this case, because we're not using a server storage node, we're using an enterprise array, that service actually coexists on the controller nodes and just talk to the whatever enterprise array, I think through the IP network. Right?
Yeah, it's through. So in this particular example and in most examples, we have what's called a management IP. That is over the 1 gig network, and you get to specify that in your configuration file. And that's where the API calls are going through. So what happens is that volume service that Ken had talked about before that in his example is running LVM and doing all these fancy things and stuff like that. In the example, when you plug in a enterprise storage device or some other, open source, whatever it might be, the difference is in those cases what happens is that volume service is actually not doing much. It's just basically turning into an API interface, and that's it. It's a driver making calls to a device, and that's about it. So this is cool, but if you go to the next slide. This is cool, but this is even better, right? And unfortunately, in this slide, I forgot to put the iSCSI connects, but this is an example. This isn't uncommon to see. So this is an example where you see we've got a SolidFire cluster, an EMC cluster, and the reference commodity storage implementation all inside of one single OpenStack deployment. And that's pretty cool, right? Because the idea is the end user, the tenant that's actually consuming this, they don't know anything about what's on that back end, and they don't have to. That's the beauty of it. So Cinder will let you do a couple of things. You can either have it set up so that a user can specify which backend to go to based on some sort of mapping, arbitrary mapping that you set up, or you can let it just go ahead and figure it out and do it on its own based on performance requirements, capacity availability, things like that. So, yeah.
How easy to automate and
I can, and I'll touch on that in a second on my specific product, because I know the most about that, right? Yeah, he asked if I could comment on the ease and functionality that it's available in terms of API, in terms of managing these different backend devices, right?
I think the point is still that, and you made this point in the panel, is the way Cinder works, it's a fairly basic level functionality. It doesn't quite get into allowing you to essentially set up the underlying array in a particular fashion. So right. So you basically, the storage, if there's a storage team that does that, they would still have to lay out the volumes within whether it's a NetApp, EMC, or SolidFire. Then hand that off essentially to the OpenStack team, who then can present that as a
So partially, yeah. So Cinder and OpenStack do not take over the role of the storage admin, so to speak. The part that it takes over is, instead of an end user saying, hey, I need a volume with these characteristics of this size and submit a ticket to the IT department that goes to the storage admin and he provisions it and then sends the info back. The difference is, The storage admin now just takes these different devices, right, and configures them into a pool inside of OpenStack. Yeah. And then they're ready to go, they're available, and they're ready to use. And then the end user is the one that makes the calls and says, hey, give me a volume, and the APIs automatically provision those volumes on those backends and stuff like that. The actual administration aspects and things like that, yeah, there are differences. And so that's where we kind of get into when I talk about the enterprise advantages. So there are definitely advantages, things like simplified scaling. So Ken pointed out, you know, talking about scaling limitations and things like that that you run into, and some of the isolation in terms of the max size and stuff like that on the nodes. Some of the enterprise devices are going to give you the ability to actually scale out horizontally without changing anything in your OpenStack deployment. So there is no need for any admin interaction or anything like that. The other big thing is when you start talking about high availability. When you want things like failover and HA and stuff like that, you're going to need to look at some other options. You know, the LVM implementation isn't necessarily going to cut it. And when I say enterprise storage advantages, that may mean another open source option or something like that. I'm just using that as a general term. So, and then that one last thing on that I did want to touch on was one of the biggest things, one of the biggest advantages of having these drivers and these enterprise drivers and these plugin models is the ability to actually repurpose equipment that you have. So, you know, people don't just all of a sudden start and have OpenStack right out of the gate, right? So they've got an existing infrastructure, they've got existing equipment. So the idea is, it's great if they can't, if they can actually use some stuff that they already have. So that helps the on-ramp. One of the things I like to talk about a lot is you know, in the open source community, people kind of like, oh, vendors, oh, enterprise, proprietary is bad. I don't think it is. I think it's great. I think proprietary is a great a platform because it gives you choices. The more choices you have, the better off you are, in my opinion. If you don't like proprietary, you don't like vendors, then don't use them. But the reality is, the more choices you have, the more competition there is inside of OpenStack, the better everybody inside of that community has to be. So it's a win-win for everybody. And then sometimes, you know, combining open source and proprietary things, it actually gives you the best of both worlds, and it's a win-win for everybody. So the hard part is, inside of Cinder, there are 24 different drivers, 24 different supported backends that you can choose from that are in tree. So how do you choose which one to use? That's a tough thing to do. The good thing is we strive for consistency inside of Cinder. So the idea is all the base functionality should just work regardless of which one you pick up and which one you use. So that's the good thing. The features and characteristics, that's what sets them apart, and that's where you get to start making your choices. So one size does not fit all. So the whole point of this is to figure out, what do you want to do with your cloud? What is your use case going to look like? And then from there, start making choices on what you need. So a lot of the things that I run into and talk to people a lot about are, how well is it integrated and supported inside of OpenStack? How much work do you do inside of OpenStack? How much work does that vendor actually do in OpenStack? And how much do they know about OpenStack? So can they actually support the product? How flexible is it? Can it scale? What does scale mean to them? Is scale adding bigger drives? Is scale scaling out and adding nodes? So on and so forth. Automation, what do the APIs look like? How easy is it to manage? Can I automate all of the management? Kind of back to some of what you asked. Some vendors you can, or some products you can, some products you can't. So it kind of depends. Predictable performance. Not just is it fast, you know, is it predictable? Is it steady? Is it consistent? It really comes down to, what am I going to be using it for? And then the hard part is, what might I be using it for in the future? But the good thing is Cinder and most things in OpenStack, it allows you to grow and scale out and change things as you grow and learn. So. And that's kind of this point. You're not locked in. The whole intent is to keep you from being locked in. The whole intent of Cinder and its abstractions is to keep you from being locked into one particular device. You can easily change the back end. You can migrate the data if you need to. And again, like I said, expect the same base level functionality. So my company, SolidFire, this is what we work on. We have a scale out, horizontal scale out, clustered storage appliance. I'm not going to go into a lot on this because we're going to run out of time, and I want to make sure Jim gets a chance to talk here. So feel free to grab me afterwards, and I will talk to you more about quality of service and the things that we do. But I think with that, we should probably
mix.
Okay. Yeah.
So
do you want to see if we have questions? Or I'll do these slides.
Okay. So how many storage administrators are here today? Anyone? So when we were putting this session together, you know, we started talking about Cinder and how everything sort of plugs in. But we also wanted to talk a little bit, and this was to your question earlier, is how does the storage administrator work in an OpenStack environment? So the first thing is that the old school storage administrator was sort of the master of his domain, right? When he had to design his storage infrastructure, the application owner came to him and said, here's the IOPS I need, here's the latency I need, here's how I want to design my environment for my application to run correctly. And he absolutely understood those requirements and how to build his SAN or his NAS infrastructure to give those services to the application owner. But things have now changed, right? It's not the application owner who's coming and talking anymore directly to the storage administrator. It's now something called the cloud architect who's coming to the storage administrator and saying, I don't necessarily know what the IOPS are going to be. I don't know what the latency of these applications are going to be. But what I need is a certain type of profile of storage that you can provide to me. And this is called a pool. So the current thing is it's all about getting into the pool, right? And in Cinder, when we talk about all these things that Cinder is offering, right, really all Cinder is looking for is from an array or some sort of SDS device, the ability to take a pool of storage and create LUNs on that, do all the masking, and then ultimately give it to the end user, right? And this is a big change for the storage administrator because the consumption of his resources is not by another administrator, it's by some user out there who he has no idea what he's gonna be actually using. So when we design these Cinder environments, we have to design profiles of storage that can actually support the workloads that are created by an end user who doesn't necessarily know what he's actually looking for. And that's why you see the rise of all flash arrays or commodity storage working very well together in a Cinder environment, so I can offer all of these different types of service through one API to be consumed by the end user. So we have a demo we're gonna run real quick here to sort of show you how that works. You can start the demo. I'm not an Apple guy. I have no idea how to use a Mac. I'm an old school, I guess. I don't know. Right. But we're going to show you this demo of how this works, and you're going to see some EMC technologies. But you can sort of ignore the fact that it's showing you EMC and sort of look beyond to the concepts that it's showing, right? So if I'm a storage administrator, how do I offer these data services in a pool functionality and provide the quality of service and the type of things I'm used to supplying as a storage administrator, like DR, snapshots, all the things that Cinder may not be able to provide?
Yeah. It doesn't look like it's showing up.
Oh, can you move it? You have to drag it over to the other screen, I think. There you go. Apples are so tough. People say they're so easy. I just want to play it from here.
I'm trying to.
Here we go. So what you're going to see here is sort of a way of offering services to Cinder, right? So again, I can directly from an array offer a pool of services to Cinder, and the volume services and everything can schedule against it. Or I can use something like SDS. What you're seeing here is EMC Viper, which is our software-defined storage platform that allows me to take all sorts of different arrays and creates different types of pools of storage that I then offer to Cinder. And in this demo, what's going to happen is I'm using a couple different arrays that I have. I'm doing just one-to-one mappings where I'm creating pools of storage on an array. I'm offering it to Viper. Viper's then offering it as a one-to-one up into OpenStack for Cinder to consume. And we can see here in Unisphere, I have these different tiers of storage. And what Cinder does is that as I talk to this controller, I then get directed to the correct pool of what I'm trying to consume based off the volume type that I created within the OpenStack, and then it actually creates dynamically the LUNs and does all the masking on the back end. And I do this through a flow. So here what you're seeing is, you know, here's the typical Horizon dashboard, and you're gonna see that I've already created a couple of volume types and I've already provisioned a couple different LUNs. And one of the really cool things that I really like about Cinder is that I can create all these different controllers, and I can have controllers talk to a certain RAID group or a certain volume type, but then I can keep adding controllers, and it's pretty simple, right? So you're gonna see here is how simple it is to add a new controller within OpenStack is that this version, this controller here, right? I've never installed Cinder on it. It's not a Cinder controller. So I go to Yum, I do the install, and then all I have to do is tell it is where the database is located, and then give it the messaging information, and then it can become another controller within my environment, and then I can actually go and consume those resources that I'm actually offering in this example through Viper.
Can I
ask a
question? Sure. How do you consume
Isilon from Cinder? In this example, we're consuming it through Viper, right? We don't have a direct Cinder driver that we've released for Isilon.
What about VNX?
So VNX, we do have a direct driver, or you can consume it. There was a slide that I whipped through really quick that showed all that. We can go back to that and show everyone, or we can get you the information. But almost all of our storage platforms today have a direct driver that's either in trunk or working towards getting in trunk to have available to use against Cinder. Excellent. So you can see this just goes on where I start actually. What I'm going to do now is I'm using GitHub to get the driver for Viper. I do the install. Once the install is done, I'll then start going through and creating a volume type from one of the services that I see offered within Cinder. Right, and this is all done within Python. I can get all these drivers for all of our arrays are available up in GitHub, other than the ones that are available in trunk. So we have sort of two things going on. We're offering our drivers to get directly released through OpenStack. And the ones that either we haven't gotten into the current Icehouse distro or working towards getting in to Juno, we offer through GitHub so that it's still, you don't have to sign up for anything. We won't email you. We won't know that you have it. You can go to GitHub and get it, and it's yours to do with it what you please. So, cool.
That's it?
Yes, that's it. It goes on and on, and we can see the rest of this.
For those of you that aren't familiar with Cinder or anything, this is definitely a little different model right now. I think it's going to change, as you said. For drivers that are in trunk currently today, typically the configuration in the process is a matter of going in and making an edit to the comp file. In my case, like for example, it might be three lines, and then restarting the service, and that's it. Until Viper is actually in trunk and stuff like that, you're going to have to do some extra stuff. So some of that doesn't necessarily apply if you're not familiar.
Okay. So we probably can take like one or two questions. Quick questions, but anyway, these are some resources that talks about private OpenStack clouds and how that can be used with Cinder. So I encourage you to, I think these decks will be make us available somewhere.
Slideshare.
On SlideShare, so
yep.
Don't worry if you don't see it, if you can't capture it all now. Yep. But before we end, are there any questions that you may have? You could try to walk to the mic, if at all possible, it'd be easy to hear you. And if not, we'll repeat the question.
Why is it specifically to iSCSI and not fiber channel?
That's not true. There is fiber channel support.
I saw
so iSCSI is predominant. So if
yeah,
you knew
so
there was,
the,
yeah.
When did the fiber channel go in?
So fiber channel went in last release,
Havana,
and then fiber channel zone management just started to go
just
in.
Coming
in
out.
So
I was wondering why.
So one of the things you'll notice if some of you guys are struggling with the whole OpenStack project versus a product, so one of the things about a product that, for example, Rackspace or Red Hat does is we don't just take everything in trunk and go, here you go, right? We take things that we think are production ready. So prior to this release, since there was no zone management, private zone channel zone management, we decided it wasn't ready for production yet, so we went with iSCSI. We will probably support fiber channel at some point soon.
So my question is about in enterprise Cinder deployment, right? In that case, when do you recommend to have more than one Cinder volume node? Would there be any conflict that if there are multiple enterprise arrays and I have multiple drivers sitting on the same Cinder volume, or would you recommend a separate Cinder volume for each?
Yeah, so currently Cinder gives you the choice. You can actually do multiple Cinder volume services for each backend driver, or you can do what we call multi-backend, which basically does an abstraction and lets you actually just iterate through. We make a fake host name for each backend name, but it still all runs on the same node still.
Are there any like scalability requirements or something to have more?
Not really, yeah. I mean, we've talked about and we're looking at different things that might come up in terms of HA and things like that that we might be interested in. Currently, with most drivers, like I said, it's usually just a pass-through interface. So there's not a ton of requirements in terms of resource usage and stuff like that. You're just talking about RPC calls usually.
Thank you.
Yep.
Probably one more question, that's it. So any other questions? Is there one more question?
So what kind of interface does the Cinder volume driver support?
So you mean just the whole gamut? So in general, there are multiple protocols that are supported in Cinder today. They include Fiber Channel, iSCSI, of course, and there is NFS, some NFS support that's being added in there as well, but eventually that's going to be moving.
In some implementations, there's an NFS export that actually then is used as a SCSI volume.
Yeah.
NetApp does that. I think maybe in the center might even do that. So
there's a few people that do that. Cluster does that as well.
So it's NFS, but it's not used as NFS. It's used as SCSI. So the last one.
It's used to pretend NFS is block.
Okay. All right. Well, I think our time is up. Thank you, everyone, for coming.
And we're available for questions after too.
Yeah.